It's all right, Ricky. It's nothing to worry about. Hitting your figures and getting good feedback, everything's going all right. Just, did you have somebody in the van with you on Saturday gone?
Oh, yeah, it's my daughter, Liza Jane, right?
Sorry, mate, we can't have that.
Well, it's my van, my insurance, my daughter. I thought it was my business.
Yeah, it is, but it's our franchise, right? Just had a complaint from one of the clients. Nobody fucks with them ever, mate, all right? It's just one of the first commandments, all right? Cheers.
I think the world of work is actually changing in front of our eyes, literally in front of our eyes. There's the technological revolution just now. Retail is changing. City centres are closing, shops closing down, and things are being delivered to people's homes. And there's an army of tens of thousands of drivers, hundreds of thousands of drivers, if you look at the whole of Europe. And technology, instead of it can be used to liberate, or it can use to, you know, chain people. And what was amazing, talking to the drivers, speaking to them, you know, you could see that every moment of their life was actually monitored and dictated, and the pressure was relentless. The little bleep, bleep, bleep of the scanner, the gun they call it, you know, you have to be there, you have to be there. You know, if there's a roadblock, you have to make up the time. And what I spent, when I spent time with them, they didn't have time for lunch, they didn't have time to go to the toilet.
That's it, it's about time. It's about time, and them not having any.
No, exactly. And it's amazing just to, when you, and then when you imagine, you know, Amazon and all these people say, but they only work from this time to that time. But when you speak to the drivers, they have to be in a holding car park earlier, sometimes 2 hours beforehand, to get into the first wave so they can get out early. So there's, and another great big change in work too is, instead of saying, like, you are now an employee, they say, no, you have the choice and you become an owner-driver franchisee, you know, and you work with us, you don't work for us. So you become like, you know, the entrepreneur of the road, the warrior of the road. You have the illusion of freedom. But what it does is like a conjuring trick in the old fairs, and you transfer risk from the corporation to them. So if there's sickness, or there's an accident, or there's a bang in the car, or mechanical failure, you bear the brunt of it. You have the responsibility to do it. And I met people who were ill, you know, really up to here, going to work, scared of fines. There's a guy called Don Lane who died of missing all his diabetic appointments because he kept losing it. And he worked a big, big pressure over Christmas for all the deliveries. And the 4th of January of 2 years ago, he died. And because he'd missed his appointments, because he couldn't get time off, because he was scared of getting a £150 fine for not being able to get a replacement driver. So what you see is the screw being turned. And what does that do to your family life when you're coming back like that exhausted?
Seb? Mm-hmm. We've talked about this. You could go to uni.
Go to uni? What, and be like Harpoon's brother, 57 grand in debt, and what, working in a call centre now, getting smashed every weekend just to forget his problems. Of course.
But it don't have to be like that, does it? There's some good jobs out there.
Good jobs? What good jobs?
Well, there is, if you just knuckle down, give yourself some options. You know, otherwise, you're just going to end up like...
Well, what, I don't like you?
Know. Oh, fucking nice.
Do you really think I want that? Really?
And then in the other extreme, Abby, 0 hour contracts. So she gets work in the morning to get the old people up. You know, work at lunchtime, work in the evening, put them to bed. And in between times, they're not getting paid. They're not getting paid for travel money. They're receiving £2.50 for a 15 minute visit, but they pay for their own travelling time. They're
going
in buses.
£2.50?
£2.50 for a 15 minute.
So it's £10 an hour, if you're lucky.
If you're lucky, but you know, you never get four houses together.
But £10 isn't, it's like three cups of coffee or whatever.
Well, exactly. And so a lot, there's a massive turnover. There's not the proper care that they get. Abby in our film is a wonderful carer. But many, many good carers just can't afford to do it, or they just can't do it anymore. So it's a huge turnover. People are not properly trained. And there's terrible stories of old people being left, you know, in nappies for 20 hours, heat not turned up. And it's a massively skillful job, because you're dealing with people who've got dementia, you know, complicated medical needs. And so they bear the responsibility for it again. So what's the point of work if you can't see your own children? There's so many carers that are out at night time putting people to bed, but they can't be back in time. One of them showed me her mobile phone, and on her day off, she had 36 texts asking her to come in to do different stuff. So there's great pressure on them. And then if they don't cooperate, they can just be cut off. So it's like a tap, on and off. Yeah. You know, so that affects people's stress in their lives, fear in their lives. I think there's tremendous economic injustice, you know, just generally speaking just now.
But,
you know,
but the thing is, I sort of knew that because I have a my mother died recently and she had caregivers and I knew that, but somehow this film brought it a lot closer to home.
Uh-huh. Well, that's a beautiful thing about cinema, because we can go in close, we can look at someone's eyes, we can listen to how Abby speaks to the old people, the people who are demented. You know, she lets the old person comb her hair. You know, these little moments of things you might not expect. That kind of delicacy of human relationships. And cinema is wonderful for that, because you can go in close and you can be intimate and you can see the world from their point of view instead of from outside.
But you can also see how hard up the guys, the caregivers are, or the van drivers are.
Yes, I think that's the beauty of cinema.
Why do you don't give me a ticket?
Your choice. If you've decided not to move on,
come on.
I've got no option other than
You can't do that.
Are you going to move down?
I'm going there.
You're going to have to go down.
I'm going there.
Why are you I've
given
you the
I buy stuff from Amazon now and again, but I don't think I want to anymore.
It's a very interesting question, isn't it? Because, you know, the model that Amazon has and many of these big corporations, you know, is because the workers are so isolated, atomized, individualized, there's no trade union movement, because technology is so skillful just now, because you get teams of lawyers to say you're an owner, driver, franchisee, they can extract enormous profit. And more of that surplus profit now is going into these big giant corporations. Is it any surprise that Jeff Bezos is the richest man in the world? It's no surprise whatsoever. Warren Buffett, you know, the great sage that they talk about, the great investor, he's now invested a huge amount in Amazon because he said before, I never thought, I had great admiration for Jeff Bezos, but I didn't think he'd be able to achieve all of this. Does Warren Buffett give a damn about the tens of thousands of drivers and the subcontracted drivers who are tied to an app? You know, who've got to piss in a bottle. You know, does Jeff Bezos ever piss in a bottle because a meeting goes on too long in his headquarters? I very much doubt it.
Me too.
But I'd love to see the cartoon, though.
Exactly. It sounds like a cartoon.
Oh, yeah. There is massive economic injustice at the heart of our societies just now. And I think it's got great political ramifications. And I think the great fear is now, when there is such a dichotomy in wealth, fear grows with that. And who takes advantage of that fear? You know, the right are experts in it. You know, all over Europe just now, they're saying, oh, the problem is, it's the immigrants, it's the people coming in the boats over from Africa. You know, it's the weakest and the most vulnerable people in our society. You know, and they are experts at taking advantage of fear and scapegoating. And I think what we have to do is say, right, where does power lie? There is a very important economist called Sir Angus Deaton, who just gave a lecture 4 days ago. He's won the Nobel Prize for economics, and he is saying Britain is in great danger of falling in the United States in terms of its massive inequality of wealth. And he's saying you will reap the political ramifications for this. That's why we've got Trump. You know, there's so many alienated people, so many desperate people, so many frightened people. For 50 years now, people who have not got a degree in the United States, their standard of living has gone down for 50 years. For the last 3 years, life expectancy in the United States has gone down. That's the first time that's happened in a century. That's absolutely remarkable. But people like Trump come in and they take advantage of all of that fear. And then they manipulate it and say, it's the immigrants' fault, let's build a wall. They're not looking at corporations who've got massive wealth. Eight people today, eight billionaires, own the equivalent of half of humanity. Now that sounds like a science fiction script from behind me in Cannes from filmmakers. That's our reality, but we hardly ever talk about it.
And can a film change that?
Films can change nothing. I really believe films can change nothing. They can help us dialogue, they can help us analyse, they can help us touch us, but unless people afterwards do something about it, you know, have got to be creative, come together and demand political change, nothing will happen. But I think stories can help.